The national election was only the day before yesterday, but even now we convene to cast its significance in concrete. On the other hand, we are splendidly equipped to do so in this company, inasmuch as both our guests have the habit of writing for the ages, or in any event of sounding as though they were writing for the ages. Joseph Kraft specifically endorsed Carter. Richard Reeves implicitly endorsed Carter. A reader of Mr. Reeves' book on the incumbent, A Ford Not a Lincoln, would deduce that Mr. Reeves would back anyone in preference to Mr. Ford. Joseph Kraft is, of course, the syndicated columnist. He was born in New Jersey, educated at Columbia and Princeton, and began his career in journalism after serving in the war in the Washington Post and as an editorial writer. He went on to the New York Times and touched base in Harper's and the Chicago Daily News. He's written extensively in the New Yorker. In 1961, he published his first book, The Struggle for Algeria, and in 1973, his most recent book, The Chinese Difference, written after traveling extensively in China, during part of which trip he was properly chaperoned by your host. Richard Reeves is the principal political reporter for New York Magazine, who has appeared on this program before. He is, by academic training, a mechanical engineer, a graduate of the Stevens Institute of Technology, but then Wallace Stevens was an insurance salesman. I should like to begin by focusing on the state of health of the Republican Party. The president apart, the salient datum of the election surely is that most of the Watergate freshmen have been reelected, perpetuating an anomaly that threatens now to be institutionalized. It is difficult to reconcile with the ideological division of the public, and it would appear it has got to get worse as men ambitious for public life are drawn almost out of necessity to the Democratic Party. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Reeves whether, given the weaknesses he celebrated in Ford, Ford's strong showing in the polls alongside the Republican Party's poor showing doesn't suggest structural difficulties.
I think that one of the things that contributed to the Ford showing tells a lot about my own view of the state of the Republican Party. I think the Republicans ran a very, very clever campaign at the top and turned the election largely into a referendum on Jimmy Carter. And by the barest of majorities, he was approved. I think that what happens beyond that, and I think the structural difficulties of the parties are very, very great, depend on Carter. I think the Republican Party will remain the opposition party, and that they are, their future in elections 2 and 4 years from now, at least, are dependent on the public's evaluation of Carter. I think that, again, we probably are going to have Carter referenda in 78 and perhaps in 1980.
Well, I understand what you're saying. I'm trying to probe a slightly different point, namely this. Do the returns of earlier this week suggest that the Republican Party carries a stigma which it appears incapable of cleansing, so that people who want a crack at public life are extremely reluctant to proceed under the sponsorship of the Republican Party, since they start out with that stigma? A lot of the people, as you know, who ran successfully, John Chafee in Rhode Island, for instance, never mentioned the word Republican, never associated themselves with the party, except in their fundraising literature to Republicans. Now, if that is so, and since all the polls seem to suggest that the Republic is in a conservative mood, do you anticipate that there will be some thinking on the question of whether the Republican label oughtn't to be allowed to just slip into the memory hole?
I think, if I can talk about that in two parts,
sure.
I think, yes, there is a stigma with the voters. The Republican Party, I think, is not seen as a party of conservatism anymore. It's seen as a party of privilege, and that is hurting it badly with the electorate. On the other hand, were I a young man ambitious in politics or a woman ambitious in politics, I'm not sure I would not try to go into the Republican Party, at least in the short run because of the way American election laws and the media are stacked, that the election laws are designed to perpetuate the two-party system so that once you get the Republican nomination, you can do anything you want with it, run as an attractive young alternative, or as Hayakawa did in California, as an attractive old alternative, running against the majority party. And also, I think that the media, particularly television, is geared to cover the two-party to cover a two-party race. The televising of the national conventions, is, I think, has as much to do with perpetuating the two-party system as almost anything in the country. So I think the stigma is there. On the other hand, ambitious people, I think, will still find the, particularly if the Republican Party continues to decrease in office holding power, it just makes those nominations easier to get for newcomers coming into the process.
What do you say, Ms. Kraft?
The first thing I think I'll say is that you'll get no lapidary judgments out of me on this election. It seemed to me to be very, very much an unlandmark election that was dominated by very, very curious and unusual regional patterns. And so I am extremely reluctant to draw any kind of general lesson from it at all. But in answer specifically to your question, I would think no. It would seem to me that there are several good indices for the Republicans. First of all, they elected some young, fresh faces, Lugar, Wallop, for example. Secondly, one of the things that I find really interesting is the weakening of the so-called economic issue. When a state like New Jersey, which I think has unemployment of over 11%, goes Republican, it seems to me that the Democrats ought to be scratching their heads a little bit and worrying a lot.
Are you suggesting that Democrats breed employment?
No, but I'm saying that the Democrats feed on unemployment, that that's a great issue for them.
Oh, they feed on ignorance.
Well, I call it unemployment, you call it Europe, but it seems to me that the country's tolerance for a high level of
unemployment... No hit and run on this show, Joe.
except by you.
You
know, that's, I think, a bootleg play if I ever saw it.
Your point is that since it is axiomatic that if you are in favor of employment, you're in favor of the Democratic Party, any state that went for the Republican Party and has unemployment as a problem isn't doing
that
as well as it ought to do.
That is too twisted a version of my own confusion for me even to unravel.
It's eventual reductionism.
Let me try to say what I'm saying. I think that in general, there's a feeling that Democrats do well when you have economic hard times, that that's an issue that they can exploit. I think that the public's tolerance for economic hard times because of various cushions has been steadily increasing, and you found it particularly, and I think it's one of the most interesting features of this election, in various states that went Republican, even though they had very high levels of unemployment. California had what, 9 or 10% unemployment?
Yeah, I can understand New Jersey. California is beyond my I never can understand what happens in elections out there.
Michigan had high unemployment. In any case, I would say I'm reluctant to say anything very...
unfriendly?
Not to you, Bill. No, I'm reluctant to say anything that's going to get cast in concrete about this election. I don't think it has an awful lot to do with the last election or the next one. But I see some positive signs for Republicans.
Well, since you touched that point, perhaps you'd want to comment on an observation made informally by Milton Friedman about a year ago. It was in a conversation in which he said that that we were walking into an economic age in which the anti-inflation party, lowercase party, it would not. Either the Republican Party or the Democratic Party, but voters, are probably as strong and as vehement and as vested an interest as the anti-unemployment party for two reasons. Number one, more people have more things that are easily dissipated by inflation, giving way to attrition. Number two, unemployment is, and I use the word emphatically, relatively painless. it was relatively painless by the standards of, say, the 1930s. Under the circumstances, people don't look at unemployment and forget all other considerations and say, I must move in the direction of doing something about it. They look at unemployment and say, well, this is unfortunate. It would be better if it were otherwise. But meanwhile, they're going to school, they're getting medical care, they're getting their welfare checks and so on and so forth. Now let's worry about the kind of attrition that would result in my losing my life savings over a period of 2 or 3 years.
And also, they're not us, the people who are unemployed. They're not us.
There's a football term momentum, it seems to me, that really you have to fit into the Friedman formula to make it work. If unemployment is rising, as it was recently, then I think people tend to be sensitive. Sure, only 10% are out, but I might be the next one forced, if it's rising. I think if inflation is rising, people get very, very sensitive to it. When it's dropping, there's no sawtooth. And I would agree with what Dick Reeves was saying, that the Republicans ran, with a lot of help from Jimmy Carter, it seems to me, a good campaign, and were able to make trust the issue. And when trust is the issue, it would seem to me that it's a very, very close race. And Jimmy Carter is not on his best wicket.
Carter also endorsed the Friedman view. I mean, that was what it was all about when immediately after the convention, he gave his only major statement, probably of a 2 or 3 week period, which was that essentially trying to say, inflation is my number one priority. I mean, and that, I think, can be attributed to his own polling. I mean, he tried to get that
point
across.
Did he use the word number one?
I don't know if he used the word number one.
I think
he said, I will hold off programs if it would feed inflation, the programs that I've advocated. It was his anti-inflation statement, and he must have perceived that and tried to get some of that vote. There is no doubt, at least in my experience of the little bit of taxi drivers and whatnot that you talk to as a political reporter, that inflation was indeed perceived as being a greater threat to me, the person you're talking to, than unemployment is. And I think Carter probably got some of that. I think he took some of that issue away from the Republicans.
Yeah, I would agree with that. But I think that if you matched up the number of times he said employment is my first priority and the number of times he said inflation is my first priority, you'd probably come out pretty even.
Yeah. On almost anything.
Yeah.
almost anything.
Well, but is this a significant trend, or is it one that one could have played with in almost any preceding election? Is there a kind of sophistication about inflation that there wasn't, say, 10 years ago?
I think there's a fear of inflation. I think the inflationary experience of 73, 74, 75 was probably the most impressive economic experience Americans have had since the Depression. Mm-hmm. And I think it has had an impact on behavior patterns, an internalized impact on what companies are buying, what consumers are buying, that we haven't even reckoned with yet. So I think inflation is a very, very big atmospheric condition. But I would really be hard put to say that it had a big electoral impact. And I guess what I'm saying is that I think this was a freak election, and one of the aspects that was freak about it was how much personality came to dominate pocketbook issues.
I disagree with that. I think it had a lot of impact. I think a lot of people voted for Gerald Ford because they were afraid of inflation, and they have perceived over the years that the Republicans are more anti-inflationary than the Democrats. In fact, with many issues running, if inflation is a stronger issue than unemployment, and I think it is, with that issue running their way, it might show up some of the weakness of the Republican Party that Republicans didn't make any real gains in this election. They may have got some attractive fresh faces, but they didn't gain an inch any place in the country.
Well, we're coming surely to a showdown. You have the Democratic Party pledged to a number of specific social objectives. Humphrey Hawkins is probably the most flamboyant of them. The other is national health. Now, every now and then, depending on his mood, on who asked the question, you would find people like Carter, certainly Pat Moynihan, saying, well, of course, we wouldn't launch these programs until we knew that they could be paid for out of increased revenues, i.e. no increase in deficit spending and no increase in taxation. However, there is now the morale of an army on the march in Congress. They've got a complacent president. Do you think they're actually going to stop and ask themselves sober questions of that sort before delivering national health and
no.
Humphrey Hawkins?
Oh, before delivering that, no. But I don't think those are the, I think there's going to be economic stimulus very quickly in the form of an additional tax cut. And I think that the talk about the Moynihan / Carter and whoever else you want to put in your bag of baddies, those people who said those things, it seems to me, knew better. I think that they were conning the public, and they know very well that there are going to have to be deficits, there's going to have to be stimulus. That's what the Democratic Party is all about. Mm-hmm. Whether it's going to be inflationary is another question, because you are so far below capacity and you have such heavy unemployment that you probably can stimulate for a couple of years without having any immediate inflationary impact if you can.
What do you do about the chronological problem? That a dollar.
Stop using these big words and tell me.
Well, you know, I certainly don't want to burden you with any economic learning. It would ruin your style. what you call the conventional unwisdom in one of your recent columns, namely that inflation does happen when the government spends too much money, is here an issue, right? If you spend $1 billion today, assuming that the multiplier effect of that $1 billion returns $1 billion, it's going to return it in due course. But meanwhile, X number of dollars are loose in the economy, which are having the effect of depreciating the value of other dollars, right? Inflation.
I think we are wandering into
economics.
Yeah, economics and other dismal subjects that we're probably better out of.
Runaway dollar bills rampant across the country.
My impression is that there's a good deal of room right now for stimulation, and that if you manage it well, you can prevent or cut short the inflationary consequences later on. Now, maybe you can't manage it well.
And good management is defined how?
Well, first of all, it's being activist about it. It's not sitting on your hands and doing nothing when the auto companies announce a price increase of, I don't know, what was it, 4 or 5% for cars that weigh 700 pounds less and clearly cost less. You can do things about that. You can sort of send messages.
What kind of things do you do?
You jawbone, you say, you say in advance, I don't want to see any big price increases, and there's going to be a lot of trouble if there is.
What if you're saying that shrinks the capital pool?
I think you can look at the capital pool and say that there are pretty ample profits now. GM, as I remember it, was way, way up.
I don't want to
come down only on one side. I think you can also do things about labor. Mm-hmm. You can indicate to them that the payroll tax is going to be coming down. And so they don't have to keep chasing price increases. I have the sense that you are now in a very favorable moment for stimulus without inflation. And I think that's what we're going to get.
Well,
going back to the original question, do you think that Humphrey Hawkins will ever be the law in this country or anything quite like it? I don't think Jimmy Carter, despite the fact that he said in the Pennsylvania primary and has said later.
It was a grudge.
I don't think he believes in that. I don't think many of the people voting for it in Congress mean it, and I don't think Humphrey and Hawkins understand it.
Yeah. And they've both been steadily watering it down. You're not going to have anything to talk about in a little while.
That will happen.
And now they're in the terrible position where they don't have a Republican president to veto it, mm-hmm. Which they were all praying for anyway.
Yeah.
I think a Democratic administration has to come out with some kind of national health insurance plan.
But I think it'll be in very slow and small steps.
And something less than the Kennedy plan.
Oh, much less. Might
be called Pale Blue Cross or something like that. But they've got to come out with something. Democrats can't take power in both the executive and the legislative and not come out with something on that.
Well, what would you say would be the ritual victories without any economic, at least with no apparent economic significance, that Congress will have to give to to the left, the repeal of 14B, for instance? Is that something that you would predict would happen almost right away?
No.
Why?
I would not predict that. Because I don't think congressmen want to vote on that kind of an issue. They want to put that one ahead of them. I think that there was in the course of the campaign a steady degradation away from big issues towards trivia. I think we're now going to come back to big issues. And the biggest issue clearly is going to be economic performance. And I don't think you're going to be fiddling around with stuff like reorganization of the government. I don't think you're going to be doing tax reform. There ought to be indeed invented a term, and I give it to you. Pyrrhic reform, after the last tax reform, another tax reform like that, and you're dead. So I would think that there would be shots in the arm, quickie tax cuts that would be temporary, and things like that that would be happening. The formulation of the administration, of who you have in it and what the relationship is between the cabinet and the White House, is certainly far more important than any reorganization plan. And I think tax reform and reorganization are both pushed way, 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 way down the pike.
I think in substance that may be true. I think we're going to see a lot of fancy footwork on reorganization, and that's going to be thrown up constantly during this administration, and that in the end, Jimmy Carter's bottom line is that in 1980 he's going to say to the American people, there were 1,100 agencies, there are now 240, or whatever the relevant numbers are. Whether the reorganization was just somebody at a drafting board redrawing boxes around things, I just think that Carter's got a winning, diverting issue in reorganization for a long time that he's going to get up and
boring.
You can't be against it, though. You can't be against it.
Well,
They were against it when it was proposed by Johnson.
Yeah. 1970.
That doesn't matter. Now they're there.
If he does that, he really gets into a long, drawn-out and losing battle with the Congress. I think it's sort of worth noting, if I can draw another lapidary lesson, another lesson from this election is that I can't name, with the possible exception of that new senator from Tennessee, Sasser, any congressperson or senator who owes election to Jimmy Carter. And that suggests to me that relations between the Carter administration and the Democratic Congress are going to be very, very tough and tight. It's not going to be a honeymoon. I don't think they're going to be great relations at all. And I think that Carter is going to see very early that he does not want to waste his energy and capital in fights with the Congress on their ground. He's going to be running his own administration. And really, Dick, if you're more the pragmatist than I am.
I think he's going to waste a lot of his capital on those things. And I agree with you with the fact that he is going to find himself at loggerheads with the Congress.
Well, certainly if he does that. But my impression of Watson and the people who've been preparing the transition is that they have early come to the conclusion that you don't want to get involved with the Congress. Do it yourself. These close friends and intimate associates of James L. Carter don't have the faintest idea what he thinks about these subjects. And I think that their first problem is going to, and probably the first problem of the transition, is going to be for these people who've been working on the transition to sell their conclusions to the president-elect, who has been going down a totally different road, because he has, as you say, been talking about reorganization, and they have been meanwhile assembling all these papers and talking to various wise men from stately academic halls and discovering that reorganization is for the birds. Now they've got to confront the man that appointed them with that wisdom, and I think that's going to be one of the very, very interesting developments, I would say, in the next week or so.
Well, I think it's the first contribution to the Carter Presidential Library. I wonder how far they're going to get. I don't know how competent they are. I don't know how good their work is. But I have a feeling it's going to be like task before task. What are the task force reports on anything? I just don't think that they'll give her. We're talking about a man who, when he comes out of that Southern one-party tradition, where the governor routinely uses the state legislature as a whipping boy. Some of them deserve it, and a man who had regularly got up and called the Georgia legislature the worst in the history of the state, as all Southern governors do. And I think we're going to come to the point where he's going to get up that and say and end up saying that about the Congress or something close to that. I don't think he'll avoid. I think he has only the most. I think he has only an intelligent overview of the American federal government, and I just wonder if he's going to get into the detail.
I would say that he and the people around him know less about the federal government than any incoming administration that
I've ever
seen.
Which may be a blessing in a way, right?
Maybe, but maybe not.
I mean, there's a certain innocence that is a useful innocence.
I would venture this prediction that if his bottom line really is governmental reorganization, not only will he bore us to death, not only will he have this terrible fight with the Congress, but he will be another one-term president. I think the American people expect, and rightly expect, a lot more.
Well, I think I give him that.
Especially that kind of phony reorganization where you decide to put the Corps of Engineers, transfer them from, I don't know, what where do you want them to go?
Post office.
That kind of junk.
Anybody who accomplished things, I want the post office. No, that's just me.
But at the same time, I mean, not disregarding the point, clearly economic stimulation is what they're going to be about first, and they're going to do it the way Democrats have always done it. And they're not going to have a balanced budget.
Yeah.
We have to pause for just a moment, please. This is a longer pause than your pause.
Okay.
10-second pause.
Have you seen any of those? Any of their work down there?
Mr. Kraft, you wrote a rather exasperated column on Mr. Carter in mid-campaign on foreign policy. You caught him up saying things like we ought to cooperate with the Soviet Union in the Middle East. You caught him up saying we ought to cooperate with the Soviet Union in finding a resolution to the Korean problem. Perhaps you would repeat your specific criticisms of those two observations, and then get on to a general observation on whether he is as unpracticed in foreign policy as you allege he is in understanding problems raised by the federal government.
Let me generalize the point that I made in that column. The column basically picked out a series of propositions stated by Carter which I thought were implicitly contradictory. And he went on later after the column. I mean, he took the usual notice that they do of wise contributions like that. And he went on and doubled it in spades. I mean, for example, in the second debate, I guess it was, he said that he favored both a free and independent Taiwan and progress toward the normalization of relations with Peking. Well, you're not going to have both of those. But I have the sense that, and perhaps I'm overgeneralizing, you know Carter better than I do, but I have the sense that one of the things that's rather special about him is that he is less sensitive than many other people are to either-or choices. He thinks he can break out of what I would consider opposite either-ors.
He thinks he's creative. That he can create some new set of circumstances.
Yeah, and I think that he feels that with a kind of special grace about himself, that it's more than thinking that he's a deft hand. In fact, Kerbo once said of him that he thinks all problems are soluble. So it would be that, I think you combine, I think there is an experience. I also think there is a relative insensitivity to what most people think of as trade-offs. So that he would be saying, for example, how much he wants to help Israel, and then 2 minutes later be knocking the Saudi Arabians. Well, you can't help the Israelis seriously unless you do it with the help of the Saudis. And it would seem to me over and over again he would get himself in between what I would think of as positions that were at least in tension if not contradictory. And I think that that's a habit of, that's part of his basic approach.
I couldn't agree more. I think that he does, I read that in your column this morning. I didn't know he had said that. I find that.
Had said what?
I find something terribly rigid and old and unusable about that feeling that that all problems are soluble. Every time the country gets in that mood, we get in a lot of trouble. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I was sorry to hear that that Carter had said that. I think that we've got a president of the United States who knows about as much as foreign policy as the average well-read American. Mm-hmm. And that all of the things that in some cases it's been unfair of Joe to criticize him for things he didn't know about. I don't think he had made the links in his mind between the Saudis and the Israelis. I'm sure he hadn't.
And I wonder whether he still has.
I'm going to be explaining my implicit endorsement soon.
Well, are you prepared to make a comparison here between Carter and Ford? Ford obviously has been in the cockpit seat and perforce knows things he didn't know before. But say the Ford of 3 years ago compared to the Carter now?
No, I think there's a... I think the comparisons weigh heavily on Carter's side. I think that he is he's much more intelligent, he has a capacity for growth that I don't think Gerald Ford has. I think he comes out of a completely different background. I mean, one of the points that I always tried to make about Gerald Ford was that 25 years of doing what he did, being a congressman, is disqualification per se for the presidency. Ford, the word that I always leaned on with Ford was he was essentially reactive. He would react to, and not even reactive on a large scale, he would react essentially to what was happening right around him, mm-hmm. not even what was happening in the country. I think that Carter is going to initiate, for better or worse.
Before we turn to the panel, let me get your views on a couple of perhaps minor matters. In looking back on the campaign and the role of Eugene McCarthy, if in fact McCarthy had given the election to Ford, in your judgment, would there have been some move to reform the leverage of third-party candidates? Or is this now a problem we're going to put aside it not having happened?
Both.
Both.
We would be going, Joe and I, would be going crazy if that had happened. The press would be going crazy. Yeah. There'd be great pressure. It did not happen. And
if we
like Carter feeling that he has a special and amazing grace, we feel in some way, once again, it worked out the way it should have. The popular will is reflected in the final result. And we think that the Lord watches over us and that will always happen. I'll bet it's put off.
Now,
some academicians will write learned treatise explaining why it shouldn't be done, but they'll go the way of all.
Eugene McCarthy said that if he achieved 5% of the vote, he would have effectively registered the discontent with the two major candidates of the American people. Now, he didn't achieve 5% of the vote. If he were here, he would probably give us all the mechanical reasons why he did not. Lack of funds, and lack of television exposure, and so on. What is your judgment as to whether there was a need for a third party candidate roughly fitting the ideological specifications of McCarthy?
My feeling about it is the reason he didn't achieve his 5% is the poll showed it was a close race, mm-hmm. and people found a difference between Ford and Carter and wanted to affect that difference. I do not think that Gene McCarthy represents anything but himself. So that I can't even talk about it seriously as his running as a political action.
But there was certainly an opening for a third person. I don't know whether it was Gene McCarthy, but one could have imagined 6 weeks before the election that some third person, Walter Cronkite, mm-hmm. might have come in and swept the board.
But Barbara Walters tried, and she didn't.
I think there was an opening, and let me underline another point that has baffled me a little bit. One of the things that we kept hearing in the early hours of television, and I guess it's hard to keep talking, was the enormous turnout and how wrong all of those were who said there would be a low turnout. We weren't wrong. There was a low turnout. You had a lower turnout this time than you had in 72, even though this time you had a contest, and even though you were further past the 18-year-old amendment, 4 years past it.
But you had new 18-year-olds coming in and voting.
In that sense, you never get past
the 18-year-old amendment.
Yes, you do.
No, it's always the first vote for X number of people.
Yeah, that's right. But 18-year-olds become accustomed. That's part of your becoming 18-year-old, mm-hmm. is voting. I mean, women. It took women 8 years before they began to exercise the suffrage in large numbers, which is why in 1920 and 24 seemed to me it dipped way down. But anyhow, let's put that one aside. The fact that you had a contest this time and you didn't have a contest last time, in itself, it seems to me, should have produced, if you were going to have a high turnout, a larger percentage of voters than you had last time. In fact, you had a lower percentage.
Just a little bit.
But I would say it was a low turnout election, basically.
I would say it was an average turnout election, and that, in fact, we were wrong. I mean, the turnout was close to 54%, and I didn't happen to get into that game, but, I mean, the talk was less than 50%.
Oh, people who said that were wrong. But I think it was a low turnout, and I think if you look at where it came up to 54, you could probably find some very, very special places. I'll bet the South was high.
The South voted very high, proportionally.
Texas was, through the roof. Wisconsin was very, very high because you could register and vote. But I have brought up this subject to get round backwards at something else. I think people had the impression that there was an awfully high turnout because it took so long to vote. Mm-hmm. And you had to wait in line. And the reason it took so long to vote is that the ballots were so complicated. Mm-hmm. You had to understand at least E equals MC squared to cast an intelligent ballot in the District of Columbia.
Mm-hmm. Did you notice that the percentage in the age brackets, the 18 to 21-year-olds voted for Ford? Then you went until you were past 44 before you started voting for Ford again. All of those people did, as did the majority of the college
graduates. I found that extraordinary.
I thought it was interesting, yeah.
I'm not sure why I can kid about it. I mean, it takes a certain while to mature, but...
Out of the mouth of babes.
It was an extraordinary thing. The only thing I can conclude from that is there's a certain kind of family atmosphere that actually Republicans take their civic duty more seriously than Democrats do. The Democrats are just kind of some kind of amorphous mirror of the United States, but the Republicans, in fact, are pretty well disciplined, and it's a family kind of thing, as it was in my family.
Oh, I think this was something that showed up even before the, not only in the vote, but showed up in the polls, that Ford had, I think because of his family, an extraordinary appeal to the 18 to 24, that it was higher in that group than others. I assume because of more identification with the Ford kids, who I think are a pretty attractive bunch.
We'll turn now to the panel and Mr. Jonathan Kaufman of Yale.
In 1968, after the Democrats lost a close election, they moved far to the left and nominated a fresh face in McGovern. What's going to happen to the Republicans now? Do you think the conservatives will capture the party by 1980? Or where are the fresh faces going to come from now that Rockefeller, Ford, Reagan are all too old to run?
Yeah, I see that. I've seen Pat Buchanan, George Will talk about them being decapitated. They lost Bill's sainted brother. They lost Brock, who were good people for them.
Taft.
I don't know. I think that they lost Taft. I don't know where they're going to go. Clearly, the conservatives are one of the great energy wells in American politics, and they have shown their capability to really take over the Republican Party. They came darn close this time. But are they going to go that way, or are they going to go out on their own and discard the shell, which Bill's first question indicated? It may be that the shell is just that. It's the snake's old skin, and they might be better off without it. I don't know which way they're going to choose to go. And with the loss of some of those people, I'm not sure who they are now either.
You want to comment on that, John?
Only with the observation, which I think may appeal to your gloomier feelings, that an irony of this election is that Gerald Ford probably was defeated in the birthplace of the Republican Party, Wisconsin.
Yeah. Well, I suppose you could say that about any state that voted against him, because they were
but
almost,
that
it was like Norman Mailer saying that he elected Kennedy.
Yeah. But that was the one that sort of broke the pattern.
Yeah, I guess
For Ford to lose Wisconsin.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Deborah Rohde is at the Yale Law School. Ms. Rohde?
Now, one of the more hackneyed questions in political discourse, usually addressed only by beleaguered high school debaters and occasionally Mr. Buckley, is whether an institution as anachronistic as the Electoral College any longer performs a useful function in a majoritarian scheme. And since, as we already noted, this recent election illustrates at least the potential that a spoiler who carries a few percentage points in a state with a large electoral block and a close popular vote could have a major distorting impact on election returns, is there any compelling reason why we should continue to tolerate that kind of an unsettling potential?
The one that we have the habit, as Dick Reeves said earlier, of believing that we're a blessed people that are somehow saved from those contingencies. But let me say that the Electoral College, I think, is we see practical evidence of its steady erosion. For example, if there had been, let's say, rampant, large-scale, and well-attested ballot funny business in New York, I still think it would have been extremely hard for President Ford to contest the election because he had gone down in the popular vote. If he had been ahead in the popular vote but behind in the Electoral College and there was something funny, then he might have gone and done it. But I think people less and less take serious the Electoral College, and I think it will slowly wither away. But we, as a people, I think, don't address ourselves to that kind of question until we get caught in the bind. Let me add one other thing that will at least take some of the confidence out of what I'm saying. I think we are in the process, midway in the process, of an evolution of election laws. In my own judgment, the campaign financing law worked a lot better than most of us thought it would, but it clearly has to be completed. So I have the sense that we're in the midst of a cycle of rewriting electoral laws, and maybe some of these anachronisms will be wiped out by design rather than drift.
There is one other argument. It's obviously for the Electoral College, which the argument happens to be eroding if you literally follow what candidates for president actually do, and it's also the argument for the primaries. No one would ever go into large stretches of this country
exactly. If
it were not for the Electoral College. You would camp. They are darn close to doing now, which is they go from regional communication center to regional communication center. So that there are places, Moline, Illinois, you can go to and you can get into three states or something at that point.
Is that where they have the Vertigo Night?
That was Glendale, California. Ford became the first president since Herbert Hoover went there the day after he was defeated. But the fact is people should go to those places, and they should go to Glendale, not to, you got to go to Glendale because you see where America gets its airline stewardesses. Everybody looks like one there. But nobody would ever go to Montana, Wyoming, if it weren't, they wouldn't go to the Deep South. They'd go to Atlanta, get the television reach from there, which will get greater. And that's one argument for in some way trying to give the states a role.
Going there is a code word for offering them something, isn't it? It doesn't really matter if they go to Montana, but it matters a lot if they don't take the main industries of Montana for granted, whether it's recreational parks or beef or whatever.
I think there is more value than that in going. I mean, it's a hackneyed argument, but and in the end, I suppose it didn't change a lot. But John Kennedy did go to West Virginia, and he saw things that he never in his life could have seen. And I think that as bad as the campaigning process is and as encapsulated as it is, they do see things that they wouldn't see if they only traveled from television studio to television studio.
Let me fortify that argument a little bit. I mean, the purpose of elections is not to produce Einsteins as president. The purpose of elections is to produce candidates who get elected and who are acceptable to the country as a large, so that when Party A wins, Party B doesn't take to the hills and begin shooting up the place. The purpose of elections is to have an acceptable result. The Electoral College tends to make the result more acceptable in places that don't get visited, so that it does have some appeal for smaller states. But I do think that it's eroding very, very rapidly, and even though he took the trouble to come here, is eroding, especially, Bill, since I think people now do play it the exact reverse way than you suggested. As I recollect it, when Carter went to Montana, that's when he came out for gun control. And what you do is go to a place that you know you're going to lose and take a stand that gets to show your courage.
Yeah, if I can just add one thing, as a New Yorker, I mean, I've seen Jimmy Carter in New York, and I know that no matter what he says, he is not comfortable here. I mean, both his and his wife's eyes roll when they're around New York. And obviously, New York can hold its own voting-wise because of the number of people. But I do want, and I had the feeling every time I saw them here, that I want their noses rubbed in it. I want them to see how people live here, that a lot of them like living here, surprisingly, and a lot of them don't like living here. I mean, I want the President of the United States to see Bedford-Stuyvesant and Brownsville and know what that is. And the artificiality of campaigning is bad, but it does often provide that opportunity.
Well, of course, they'd come to New York even if Ms. Rhodey's reform were enacted.
Yeah, but they might just go to Rockefeller Center and do their taping and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And justify to themselves by now we're reaching New Jersey and Connecticut at the same time. This is really a regional television spot. We're not even going through the motions of pretending that we're here because we care. He came because he cared, right? Rockefeller in Oregon.
That's right. Mr. Ralph Cavanaugh is also in the Yale Law School. In fact, he's married to Miss Rhodey.
One of the dramatically different things about this election was supposed to be the $21 million spending limit. In 1972, Mr. Nixon spent three times as much, Mr. McGovern twice as much. I'd be interested in your reaction as to whether these apparently draconian limits, as Mr. Mondale called them yesterday, affected the way the campaign was carried out or the outcome.
They certainly affected the way the campaign was carried out, and in several ways. One way, I think we ought to recognize, I don't think there was a lot of bribery. I didn't notice any guys going around with white envelopes.
Pocket money, there was not.
Yeah,
there wasn't.
I mean, that kind of thing was stamped out, and I think it's a good thing that
there was. Well, there was in the primaries, I think.
A little. Yeah. But much less than. I mean, it was really embarrassing in the days when people would tell you that the worst thing in life was to receive an envelope with four $100 bills.
That's
because
right.
They didn't know whether the person had taken one or six.
But you take your bribery now in form of social perks. You know, more aid in New York City, cheaper subways. That's the same as money, isn't it?
Well, that's off the question, though.
That was one consequence. Yeah. Another consequence was that there was much less money available for sort of local activities like bumper stickers, buttons, and things like that. And I think the campaign was at a very, very low level until the very last 2 weeks or so. Some people thought that was bad, others thought it was good. I don't think it was so bad. It would seem to me probably the worst feature of the law was the little hole that the Supreme Court carved into it. That exempted, you lawyers should pay attention to this, that exempted individuals.
I thought it was the Bill of Rights that did that, not the Supreme Court.
Perhaps.
that little hole created by the Bill of Rights.
Well, it was an interpretation of the by the court of the Bill of Rights, with which I was sympathetic.
The contumacious is on their show, huh?
But it
in fairness, of course, they eliminated some of the Bill of Rights and left only that one bit of it. If you happened to be named Hines or DuPont or Rockefeller or Danforth,
if you were named
Reeves or Kraft, it didn't help a heck of a lot.
Well, if you haven't been called Mailer, you can write books that Rockefeller can't write.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So,
is that a hole?
I'm not named Mailer.
or Reeves.
I would think that would be one of the features that they would want to write. On the whole, I think the law worked a lot better than most people thought it was going to work.
I kind of agree with that, although I must say, the local headquarters thing and the ability of local committees to raise and spend money, I think, should be back in, even if it means walking around money is going to be distributed. I mean, there should be headquarters in neighborhoods and on main streets in towns, and people out proselytizing their neighbors. And boy, I didn't see any of it.
I didn't either.
I mean, you know, obviously the best way to spend money is on this thing, and they did it.
I think Mondale is right when he suggests that the limit ought to be raised. I think it would make sense to raise the limit, and given the amount of money we spend on, say, on other things like cosmetics, we could probably spend a little bit more than we do on politics.
But does that assume that there's a correlation between the amount spent and the quality of the candidate achieved?
No.
Well, then why do you want to spend more?
Because I think you can stimulate interest and action with more.
To get better?
No, to get participation.
What's the value of participation if you don't get better candidates?
I think the value of participation is that this is a democracy and that people ought to be part of the civic community. I am indeed astonished at that question, to which the answer seems to me so self-evident. But surely you are not going to push me into the trap.
I hadn't thought that stimulation. I hadn't thought that the participation is something that is stimulated by the expenditure of money at the top level. I mean, I can understand that.
I think testifying to the same experience.
The Yale Law School people would be more interested in civic affairs because more money is spent by Mondale.
Well, we're not worried about Yale Law School people.
We really aren't.
Well, I am.
They're going to get by, and they're going to participate. But at least my experience, and I take it yours was the same, that because there weren't these bumper stickers, because there wasn't money from headquarters for doing a whole lot of things that people do that are part of the fun and hoopla of local politics, it dropped dead.
The advantage isn't only in candidates. It is in giving people a stake in their society and in their country. And I think that we sanitize that right out of business. I don't know how to do it. I mean, these people are from Yale Law School. The legal issues are so mind-boggling to me, because I have great trouble with the freedom of speech aspect, and money is speech. And if not only H.J. Hines's money, everybody's money should be. I suppose you could do a clever thing, like if you had a lot of W. Clement Stone could have declared himself a candidate, and then he could have legally transferred his money to other candidates running in the same jurisdiction. I mean, there's something mind-boggling.
You told me he was trained as a mechanical engineer.
No, my father was a lawyer.
Mr. Buffen.
You know, before the election, there was a lot of talk that the whole campaign was too long, that it dragged on through too many primaries, the campaign was too long, and Jimmy Carter is living proof that that worked. For 22 months and 500,000 miles, he just kept on repeating the same thing. Are we going to see Republican governors declaring for the presidency, say, in March, in order to meet all the American people? And isn't one of the problems with that is that people just don't care anymore?
Well, I think, I want to jump in at that point, because I think one of the great, I don't think the press did a particularly good job in this campaign, and one of the things, you've got to understand, the press wants to cover politics, not government. Government is difficult. Politics tends to be more fun. So that the press and candidates in general don't want to govern, they run for office for a living, have kind of conspired to make this campaign run for 2 years. And then they go out and say, my God, nobody's interested. What apathy there is out here. I mean, the old pals I know in New York always told me that people did not get interested in elections until the World Series was over. And maybe 2 weeks is long enough for people to get interested, and maybe we're all out of step and should start considering that. Maybe we should begin to, if a Republican governor does that and begins to run for president, I hope I am among the first to attack him, and I hope many people in the press will attack him, which would then kind of dampen his enthusiasm about making a public fool of himself rather than governing the state of...
But it worked for
where's
Carter.
Where's a Republican still governing?
I mean, Carter won because he had all that time earn the name recognition.
I'm not sure I'm ready to accept that quickly, and I'm not sure that Carter could not have won other ways. But I think it's a real danger that that's going to happen. But I think that the press should be a watchdog over that as they try to be over other things. I mean, we can't allow these people to do nothing but campaign.
Ms. Rudy?
Another question that's likely to be buffeted about in the aftermath was whether, on balance, the debates were really that salutary an exercise. And a number of commentators have been troubled by the fact that disproportionate attention was focused on certain memorable, fatuous comments, for instance, the liberation of Poland, and not enough on evasive answers to probing inquiries. Do you see any antidote for that in future, or ways, alternative ways to structure that kind of a forum?
I'm not sure that debates are the best way to choose presidents, but if you're going to have them, there are certainly some important improvements that could be made in the formula. For example, it would seem to me very useful to be able to ask for each questioner to ask two questions rather than to be confined to one. That's a recipe for disjointedness.
If you questioned in the second or the third debate?
The third.
Third, yeah.
And tried to ask the same question, one question of both candidates, and failed. You could certainly improve the format. It would be useful, it seems to me, to have the candidates asking each other questions. But it just isn't a very satisfactory way of doing things, I don't think.
I'm very pro debate. I think we can lose sight of the forest for the trees on that particular thing. Those debates were dreadfully structured, and there was a lot wrong with them. On the other hand, the American people got a fairly decent representation of who Gerald Ford and Jimmy Carter were from those debates, a heck of a lot better than they would have gotten from television commercials and flying around in jet planes.
Thank you, Mr. Reeves. Thank you, Mr. Kraft. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the panel. Thank you all.
Printed, bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. That's Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content and was funded in part by public television stations.